where we acknowledge the traditional territories of the Coast Salish peoples on whose lands the Simon Fraser University campuses reside. And I say we because this evening, many of the units that are involved in what we call the Engaged University have come together to make this evening possible. SFU Carbon Talks, the City Program, the SFU Centre for Dialogue, and Sustainable SFU, the students. Where are you, SFU Sustainable? Thank you, students. Appreciate that. Many of you have been in this room before for many of the events, and we want to invite you back continually. This campus, as those of you who come here regularly know, is an extraordinary place of continual activity. So just some upcoming events. Come back on May the 2nd for those of you who attended the City Conversation this afternoon, one of our best, every first and third Thursdays. There'll be a City Conversation at 12:30. You don't have to register. You show up. You participate. You are part of the conversation. And the one on May the 2nd, are you... Michael, what's the title? Are You Being Heard? Participation. Thanks, Michael. Public participation. That evening, tubes. Tubes and exchanges. We all have this intimate relationship with the internet, but what is it? We don't even think of it as a place, and it is. And we're going to have, I got to say, a book written by Andrew Blum, who will be speaking that evening here in this room. It was one of the best books that I read last year. On the third floor of this building is actually an exchange where the internet physically lives. You're going to learn more about that. And if you think you have an understanding of the internet, well, you'll understand it a lot better after that evening. Then on May the 6th, SFU Public Square will be holding the Child Poverty Forum. That's going to be down at Woodward's, one of our other campuses down here. For all of this, you can go to www.sfu.ca/public square and find out more. Now, the usual details. You know how to click it. You may also want to, if you go on to Twitter, go to #BCTranspo, one word. #BCTranspo. For those of you who know how this works, you can communicate. And we, there we go, you got it. We also want to ask if, in addition to the candidates we have speaking tonight, there are any others here who are running. You are. Please stand up. Oh, this is great. All right. Just tell us who you are, what riding and party you are with. Introduce yourself.
Ana Santos, West Vancouver City Sky for the NDP.
William Gibbons, independent for Vancouver Point Grey.
Ian Tootle, Vancouver False Creek with the BC Conservatives.
Marcus Halliday, Excalibur Party, Abbotsford Mission.
Regan Zhang for Vancouver Langara, Green Party of BC.
Oh, this is great. Thank you very much. Not just for coming, but for running. You know what they say about politicians? I know, I've been one. They only care about the next election. Well, two things about that. So they should. This is their moment of accountability. These people on this stage tonight and our ability to interact, to question, to listen, to hear, well, that is how the system works. So if they're doing their job, they are thinking about the next election. This is a really remarkable moment that we get to exchange where collectively we have some influence. The system doesn't work. But where I take umbrage with the idea that they only think about the next election, you know, that's not possible. You can't do that, particularly for transportation. You have to think in terms of even 100 years. You have to think about the debt, and that means you have to think about the taxes. You have no choice. You, perhaps more than most of us, actually have to think about the future. So, yes, the politicians have on one hand to think about their immediate accountability, and tonight they have to think about the future, and we get to participate in that. So that's what makes this moment special for us, all of us who've put this together this evening. We want, of course, to thank you for coming, for the politicians for being here, and we look forward to this evening. And that's my job. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon.
And now I turn it over to Shauna Sylvester, who's the Executive Director for Public Square and Carbon Talks. Shauna.
It is wonderful to look out into this audience. I don't know if you take a quick look to look behind you. The rows go on for some time. I realize looking at this weather, thinking about, you know, you've worked or you've been with the kids or you've been doing something today and you could be anywhere else tonight, but you chose to be here. So I just want to take a moment to thank all of you for being here, and I think this is going to be a fun and exciting and interesting, and if not a bit provocative evening. That's what we're hoping for. I want to explain a little bit about how the format goes for this. Someone once said I should become a timekeeper on the German train system. I tend to keep things pretty tight. This is going to be a tight evening in terms of the timing, so that there's fairness and equity in terms of the responses among each of the parties that are here. In a minute, I'm going to introduce to you our candidates, but before I do, I want to just go through each of the format pieces. First of all, each candidate will have 2 minutes to speak. So they will have 2 minutes to provide an opening statement. We have the lovely Janet Weber here, who is our timekeeper. She will be posting a yellow card that is a 30-second time frame. You know you have 30 seconds, and when that red card goes up, that's when I start intervening. That's time out, and so I will stop you there, and I will be brutal. I'm just letting you know I will be brutal. After the 2 minutes, we are opening it up to you. We have 3 roving mics. I just would ask the 3 people who are with the roving mics. There we are. You have 1 minute to ask your question. Part of what we're doing here is we're also keeping that tight. So 1 minute, and then our candidates will each have 1 minute to respond. You can direct your question to a specific individual, in which case I might give a bit of leeway if it's just one person being asked to respond. But 1 minute to respond. At the end, we are going to allow our candidates 2 minutes to wrap up, and then we'll close the evening. So that's how the format is going to go for the balance of the night. I'm looking forward to it. And I just want you to note, I hope that you saw that there are cameras here. There are many cameras here, both still photography and our webcast. We are live webcasting, and we know that there are dozens of people online as well watching this, and they will be tweeting their questions. We'd ask them to tweet their questions to hashtag BCTranspo, and Chris Scully, who is here, is going to provide us with those questions as well. 1 in every 4 questions, we're going to go to the computer world, ask them what Twitter's got to say. So we'll have a chance for those watching through live webcasts to contribute as well. So let's get underway. And the way I'd like to get started is with a few introductions. So I'm going to introduce all of our candidates and then allow Jane to go first and with her opening comments in the 2 minutes. So I'm going to start with Jane's bio. Jane Sterk has led the Green Party of BC since October 2007 and is running in this provincial election in the riding of Victoria Beacon Hill. Jane has come the furthest today to be with us. Jane ran as a federal candidate in 2004 and as a provincial candidate in 2005 and 2009. As a councillor in the township of Esquimalt from 2005 to 2008, Jane worked actively on sustainability initiatives. Jane is a successful entrepreneur. She co-owned a retail store in the computer industry that created 60 full-time jobs during her 10 years there as president. She has a PhD in counseling psychology from the University of Alberta and worked as a mental health consultant with the Edmonton Board of Health, specializing in family therapy and organizational development. Jane is a mother of 2 and a grandmother of 2, I believe. She is a past director of the Rotary Club of Victoria Harbourside and a tireless advocate for the green movement in Canada. Jane, I'm going to allow you to go forth with your 2 minutes, and then we'll move to Harry.
Well, I want to thank the organizers of this event. It's very important to think about transportation and how we live our lives. because from the Green Party perspective, that's part of the question. Transportation is part of the way that we form our communities. It's part of the way we make our choices about who we associate with, how we live, and what we do. And I think that we would all agree that our transportation systems are not serving us well at this point in time, whether it's in the Lower Mainland or in other parts of British Columbia. We see things like congestion. We see things like gridlock. We find people spending inordinate amounts of time in their cars. We find people in single occupancy vehicles adding to that congestion. And so our transportation systems are not helping us form the kinds of communities that we need to have right now, and certainly into the future, as we were reminded that this is really a question of, well, how are we going to shape our communities going forward for the next 100 years? And when we're looking at transportation as a much bigger land use issue, as a much bigger community issue, then we have to look at things like how do we get from work to home, from home to school, and how do we make sure that those communities serve us. One of the things I feel most proud of my time in Esquimalt is that I pushed our community to adopt a pedestrian charter because we wanted to make ours a pedestrian-friendly community. And that's one of the aspects that we have to look at when we're creating the kinds of communities that we need for the future. And our philosophy is about living our lives well in community, and we do that through a community-based economy and rethinking our economic structure.
Thank you, Jane. It's wonderful. Wonderful also in that you kept straight to that 2 minutes, so I appreciate that. Harry Bains was elected as the MLA for Surrey Newton in 2005 and re-elected in 2009. Harry serves as the opposition critic for transportation. Harry's been active in the Surrey community for many years. His experience in education, having served on the Kwantlen Board of Governors between 93 and 99, and he's volunteered with many organizations, including groups like Habitat for Humanity. Harry was an elected officer of the Steelworkers IWA Canada Local 2171 for over 15 years. He served most recently as the vice president of his local, where he led negotiations and engaged in bargaining for better working conditions for working people. Harry and his wife, Ravinder, I should know that, live in Surrey. They have two children, Kalpreet and Jasmine. Harry.
Thank you. And the presence here tonight just shows how concerned people of Lower Mainland are about our transportation issue. And I just want to thank you for coming here and showing your support and advice on how do we move forward. Ladies and gentlemen, we will have 1.2 million additional residences moving in Lower Mainland in next 30 years. Rather than planning and be ready to move those people and the goods to service those people, we are moving backward. To meet today's demands, the TransLink suggested that we need 415,000 new hours right now. But because of lack of funding, due to the lack of leadership from Victoria, what we have gone is we've gone backward. 306,000 of those hours had to be cut back. So we're moving backward. We don't even have the services to meet the needs today. The whole thing started because of Victoria's lack of leadership on this issue. Rather than working with local mayors, they've been fighting with them, finger pointing, blaming with them. And as a result, we have a system where we have a dysfunctional relationship between Victoria and the local mayors. We have a decision-making process as TransLink that is flawed, undemocratic, and lack accountability, and there's no transparency. Bad decisions in Victoria, such as making carbon tax as a revenue neutral, and insisting that certain project must be P3, is costing TransLink more, and it is making us making us to pay more and going continue to go to our citizens for more money every time we need additional services. So I think we need to fix the leadership in Victoria. We need to come and work with the local mayors so that we can put the system together that will serve the people of the Lower Mainland. Thank you.
Thank you, Harry. Minister Polak. Mary Polak is currently running for her third term as the BC Liberal candidate for the riding of Langley. She is the current BC Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure and has previously served as Minister of Children and Family Development, Minister of Aboriginal Relations and Reconciliation, and Minister of Healthy Living and Sport. Mary is an experienced BC leader who has also served as Surrey School Board Trustee and Chair. Mary lives in the growing neighbourhood of Willoughby and Langley, so she understands firsthand the issues that are important to the community. Mary.
Thank you very much, and thank you all of you for your interest in what is a truly important topic, especially for our province, and in particular for Metro Vancouver. When I became Transportation Minister, it was after having portfolios that were really largely in the social category. Nobody really gave you very much advice. They didn't stop you on the street and tell you their ideas. When I became Transportation and Infrastructure Minister, that all changed. I not only had people telling me all of their ideas, because everybody uses transportation in one way or another, they all have ideas about it. I also found out that there's a significant number of retired engineers living in British Columbia, and they all had my email address. I say that because transportation, I did not think, was nearly as complicated as some of the files I had previously held. And I was a little frightened, but also pleased to find out that it was truly one of the more complex files of any ministry in government. Every community has a different issue. Every region has a different priority. Everything from burgeoning growth in the Lower Mainland and transit needs for expansion, as Harry's laid out, to whether or not we're applying enough dust suppression in the North Peace. That's equally important to them as our crowded buses on the Burrard Corridor. So you have the issues that reflect the very heart of every community. And as Jane says, they also serve to form our communities. Langley's a very good example, a community that has been reliant on cars to get downtown for decades. Finally, now this morning, I'm on the express bus going across the Port Man. You've got a packed bus with about 8 people standing up. That was unheard of decades ago. There's still more to be done. But growth is that double-edged sword. It's better than decline, but it poses the challenges and puts all these systems under stress. And I'm glad to have the opportunity to dialogue with you about all of those stresses and possible solutions tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Duane Nickull is running for the Conservative Party in Vancouver Point Grey. BC Conservative Party in Vancouver Point Grey. Duane was a co-founder of Yellow Dragon Software Inc., which he sold to Adobe Systems in 2003. He continued working for Adobe until 2011 when he launched a new venture, Technorical Advanced Systems Inc. Duane is an author, an entrepreneur, and a seasoned lecturer on technology and computer systems. He's a father of 3 and comes from a long line of politically active family members. He has represented Canada at the United Nations working on technology issues, and he has recently been with the United States Department of Energy on renewable energy projects as a technical advisor. Duane is also a former World Cup mountain bike racer and cycling advocate. Duane.
Thank you. So before I introduce myself, I just want to acknowledge each and every one of you for taking a couple hours out of your busy schedules to come down here and listen to us. And I also want to stay around afterwards and listen to some of your ideas. My name is Duane Nickull. I'm a family man. And Mary, I live in Point Grey and I have some great ideas for the transit corridor there.
Excellent.
I'm going to talk to you after about that. I've been in computer software for most of my life. I work with informatic systems, so I work with data and facts. A lot of my life I've spent just working strictly in a sort of generic domain in that industry. And lately I've started working with the U.S. Department of Energy on several renewable energy projects. I'm a big fan of a lot of the renewable and clean energy projects and technologies that exist, and I think we have a huge opportunity here in British Columbia to develop it. We're talking about an industry where we could develop jobs. And when I talk about jobs, I talk about sustainable jobs, which to me mean jobs that originate in BC and stay in British Columbia. I'm going to disagree slightly with the sentiment that transit isn't working too. The first year of the Canada line, it carried 38 million people. At the DOE, one of the things I learned was one of the places you can be most effective in cutting back on GHG gas releases and improving the quality of people's lives is in large-scale infrastructure projects like high-speed electric rail. I think Vancouver has done fairly well in recent years with that, but it's just a start. I think we have to go a lot further with this. When I was a little boy, I'll confess I wanted to be a train driver, so maybe I'm a bit biased towards that. I used to commute on a bicycle from Coquitlam to Yale Town every day, and I realized that isn't a solution for everybody. We have to find a solution in this dialogue we're having tonight, and I'm very excited to listen to your ideas about what can work for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. And I have to say, that is how it's done. All of you stayed within your 2 minutes. That was very impressive. So now we're going to, because we want this to be a dialogue with you and with our candidates, we are immediately opening it up to your questions. So I'd like those of you that have questions to raise your hands, and I will also go to our Twitter feed as well if there are any questions coming forward. So I have question one here, question two here, and question three over there. Question one. I'm going to ask those of you when I've directed, come out to the if you can. It just makes it easier.
maybe.
Or maybe it doesn't, but I think it makes it easier.
Well, we don't want to.
Yeah. Hi, I just wanted to touch on governance very shortly, and I'm sure you've all read the report that was done on the recommendations from the consultants on governance for TransLink. One of the things that I thought, I'll come up with an idea and I'll throw it at you and see what you think about it, is that having directly elected people on the Metro TransLink board from the various regions around the Lower Mainland. So what would it be like Surrey White Rock would send two people, Vancouver UBC would send two people, Burnaby New West would send one, the Northeast sector would send one, Langley, Rich Meadows would send one. So it would be representative of the population. You would have 9 people on the board, and they would make the decisions directly voted by the constituencies, by each of them. So they would be on the ballots of those individual municipalities. So I throw that out at you. Like, it's
okay,
too
so
short,
a
minute's too
question.
Short to explain it all, but...
So that's a question related to governance from Grant, I believe, from Surrey. So if you have a chance, introduce yourself as well when you get the mic. So I'm going to start with Duane. And Duane, I think the question's related to the recommendations on governance and if there's a model here that Grant has suggested that...
Yeah, well, Grant, the BC Conservative Party is fully adapting to the whole idea of open government, transparent and accountable. Certainly anything's going to be an improvement over what's going on now, and our position is that we believe that the plan would have make a lot of sense, because the ability to be accountable to the taxpayer for that and the transit rider is very important. The regional approach, I think, would actually work very well. I'll leave it at that. It sounds like a good idea.
Okay. It's one of many good ideas. Context-wise, I literally spent a half-day meeting with Ken Cameron, Marlene Grinnell, who is on the former TransLink board and the current chair of TransLink, and a number of staff as we try to wrestle with what findings we might bring forward for legislation. That is one of the thoughts, albeit maintaining a professional board for day-to-day operations, but having an elected board regionally. I'm still of two minds, and the reason being that you have to ensure that you're not going to have one part of the region with more weight than another in making the decisions, so we'd have to balance that, and I'm not sure if the public's ready for one more election, but I think you're on the right track. The challenge is how to incent those people to think and behave regionally rather than parochially. Harry.
Thank you, and I agree. The report that just came out was commissioned by the Mayor's Council, and the report said that the five or six, the key criteria to have a good governance and accountability and transparency being the key of those six, none of that exists in current governance model that we have today. So we have to change that. And I agree that we need to put those people who are accountable to their constituents, who are elected from different regions, to come back on the TransLink board, make decisions for transportation, and because those are the people who make a decision on land use, those two things go hand in hand.
Thank you. Jane.
Theoretically, the Green Party agrees. We do think that there needs to be more elected representatives on the boards of these major organizations that are making decisions on our behalf. When we look at nine people representing communities or communities of this size, it's hard to imagine how those people will be a representative voice of all of the potential users of the system and representative of all the needs related to transportation planning. And so theoretically, yes, we agree with elected boards. We also believe that there needs to be local government, real local government representation. And then we have to find ways to engage the community in really participating in the decisions that are made in the interests of the community as we move forward.
Thank you. Question number two, I believe. Jackie, yes, you've got it. Question number two.
Hi, my name is Patrick. I am from Richmond. And my question is related to the transit funding and more especially to the road pricing. And let's imagine basically here, TransLink, the Council of Mayor, decide to go to the road pricing road. So my question is, will you entertain it, so basically pass the legislation to enable it, or do you gonna pass the buck to a referendum or something else? So basically, I would like a straightforward answer, yes or no.
So Patrick, I just want to be clear on your question. Your question is regarding road pricing
yeah.
and whether or not they're going to pass legislation in relationship to road pricing.
Yeah.
Okay,
whether
I think we've got it. Thank you.
For it. Yeah.
Okay, this time I'm going to start with Jane.
The Green Party believes in using transportation demand management strategies like congestion pricing, road pricing, parking pricing. We also support pay-as-you-drive insurance as ways to use mechanisms that we have, financial mechanisms, to change our behavior, moving us toward less car usage. That has to be done in parallel to in improving our transit system so that we make sure that we can get people efficiently from home to work, work to school. So those are big issues that need to be done in parallel.
Harry.
Thank you. And I think, you know, what you're suggesting is to come up with the long-term sustainable funding formula so that we could have funding to pay for the needs that we have today and moving forward next 20, 30 years. What we have said is that there is some money already in the system by way of carbon tax. Some of the carbon tax money is being used to give corporations tax breaks. We have already said that we will roll back those tax breaks by another percent, and that should free up over $200 million. And some of that money, because it comes from the province, some of that money will go to the TransLink table with a new board, and we will find out exactly how much is needed today and how much do we need to move forward looking at the population growth that we talked about.
Great. Thank you. Mary.
Thank you. So currently, the process we're engaged in with the Mayor's Council has us agreeing to work firstly on governance, secondly would be on short-term funding, and thirdly would be on long-term. Clearly, the road pricing idea would fit more likely into the long-term strategy. There are a range of different types of road pricing. There's everything from straight road tolling, like you see in the Portman Bridge, to distance tolling. Which gets at some of the types of features that you see advocated by those who are looking to control demand as well as fund transit systems. Whichever we end up choosing, it would be a result of the work we do with the Mayor's Council, and we've committed that that would then be brought into legislation. But the short-term funding would go to a referendum in 2014 in the fall, and then we would begin our work on what the long-term sustainable funding mechanisms would be. It would depend on what type of road pricing you were talking about probably not straight road, straight tolls, but perhaps distance tolling or others.
Our party has actually been opposed to the road tolls unless there's a reasonable alternative. John Cummins, our party leader, has suggested previously that, you know, instead of building yet another lane of highway out to the valley, that we should have maybe used that to put in high-speed electric rail. This is something that we don't think is fair if you don't have an alternative. If you're in Langley and you have to commute to go to work every day, that's an unfair tax burden. I wish I could wave a magic wand and fix it and they would have some other way to travel, but I can't. I'm not a magician. I'm a realist. As far as the carbon tax, you know, some of it going to corporations doesn't tell the full story. In the 2012 budget, if you look on page 61 to 66, I think out of the $1.1 billion collected, $800 million of that is going back as tax breaks to corporations. That's something to ponder.
Great. Thank you. Question number three.
Thank you. My question is similar to the gentleman. My name is Thomas. My name is Thomas Bayer. I live out at UBC. It took me almost an hour to get here, taking the bus and walking to the bus and walking here. By car, it takes me 20 minutes. What measures do you propose to reduce car usage specifically in Vancouver or Metro Vancouver? Because car use is far too convenient today and far too inexpensive. So you go over Lionsgate Bridge, it's free. Second Narrows, it's free. Drive to UBC, it's all free. You go to London, it costs you £10 to enter, which is about $16. Gasoline is quite cheap in Vancouver compared to Europe, for example. Do you propose to increase those gas taxes, for example, or car use, make it more inconvenient, while you in parallel try to find funding for electric systems such as a UBC line?
Great. Thank you, Thomas. Mary, I'm going to start with you.
Sure. Well, so what we're talking about, though, is human behavior. Right? And I had I'll use my Langley experience, right? So there have been buses to get you to SkyTrain from Langley. There have been buses to get you to SkyTrain from Langley for quite a number of years. Weren't getting a tremendous amount of use. Why? Not because they weren't inexpensive, but because they were very, very inconvenient. So for the general public, I don't think you can go simply at one place and say, well, we'll raise gas taxes, then people won't drive. Or we'll raise the price of cars, they won't drive. You have to combine price incentives with convenience. With the express bus now, the reason people are using it is because it comes frequently enough, and it's not as much of a hassle as taking an hour to get through Surrey on a bus. So we have to remember that human behavior isn't just about what costs us. It's also about what we experience. And if we're able to sit in our car and listen to music and get there in a comfortable time, to make transit possible, we have to make that as convenient for people.
Harry.
Thank you. And I think human behavior changes if you give them affordable, efficient alternative to cars. And we haven't done that. On one hand, when the carbon tax were brought in, it was meant to discourage people to drive cars less, but we failed to give them alternative mode of transportation. So they continue to drive car, and there's no alternative mode. So that's the reason. And also, I think this notion that everyone traveled to downtown Vancouver is wrong. South of the Fraser, 82% of the trips that are taken south of the Fraser remain south of the Fraser. So we need to deal with regionally and overall picture, keeping that in mind, how do we connect with each other, how do we connect those town centers that we have in different parts of the Lower Mainland with buses and with SkyTrain or LRT technology. That's the overall picture that we have to take a look so that people are driving less, leaving their cars behind, but they have an efficient and affordable and user-friendly system that they could go to.
Okay. Since you mentioned London, I'm going to point that out as a primary example. I haven't taken a taxi from Heathrow into downtown London for probably about 6 or 7 years because the Heathrow Express gets you there in 20 minutes and a taxi takes you 45 minutes. To me, it lies with the enticement of people to a more affordable and a more enjoyable experience. You know, if you had built down the middle of Highway 1 a high-speed electric rail instead of another lane of cars, which just moves the congestion a little bit further to Vancouver before it backs up, the very first time somebody in a car was stuck in the traffic and they looked by and all these people were sitting back, sipping cappuccinos, reading their books as they were going, you know, yeah, it'd be like, tomorrow I want to do that. And I think that's the kind of planning we have. Now, we've got a challenge. Unlike, we can't lay out our city in a hub and spoke like Vienna, which is one of the best cities for transit in all of Europe. We can't just rip stuff up. So it remains a challenge.
Thank you. Jane. I congratulate you for taking the bus and spending that extra time when it would have been easier in terms of your time management to take your car. And I think that it takes that kind of commitment when you do understand the consequences of our choices. But it is frustrating when that happens. There is another alternative that we're seeing here tonight that may address some of the things that we need to think about as in terms of how we live our lives. There is a live stream of this event so that people are able to watch this event from their homes. They're able to send in questions on Twitter and participate in that way. And sometimes I think we need to make our choices about how we live our lives to be more in our communities rather than assuming that we always have to travel somewhere in order to participate.
So the next question I'd like to take is on Twitter. So, Chris.
Sure. The first question comes to us by email. A resident of Saturna Island asks, ferries are the transportation arteries and the public transit of coastal British Columbia, much like roads in the interior or TransLink in the lower mainland. The province pays for 100% of the cost of the roads and 100% of the costs for the 14 inland ferries. Why are coastal taxpayers and visitors to the coast treated differently from those who live and travel elsewhere in the province?
Harry, I'm going to start with you first.
Thank you. And it is a serious concern. And the people on the along the coast and on the island, it's a lusty city is gone to a position where the rates of the ferries are gone up and the ridership are come down. And coastal communities are suffering economically and they feel that they are stuck there and that they're not getting the help that they need. What we have suggested that we will freeze the ferry rates for next 2 years. In the meantime, do a study so that we know exactly what the needs are and how do we fix this ferry system so that taxpayers both sides of the water get the benefits that they deserve and they need.
Great. Thank you. Jane, I'm going to go to you.
I think that the question recognizes that there is some inherent unfairness in how we have structured our ways of transportation. I think the figure is about $2,000 a year per car that we subsidize for our highway system. And we do need to find ways of pricing that into our car usage so that partly to discourage people from using their cars as much. And we do need to look at how we're going to use the ferry system to get people where they need to go. And it is a very big, complex problem. And I think that all of these questions that we're getting tonight address a huge issue that we all need to face, is that everybody's demands cost a huge amount of money. And we have to, at some point in time, identify our priorities, make sure that our revenues are directed toward those priorities, and making sure that we have sufficient revenues to get done what we wish to get done.
Thank you. Duane.
Yeah, there's two core tenets in the BC Conservative policy platform, and one of them is fair taxation. And what you just described on email with the ferries is a form of unfair taxation for those that is forced to take the ferry. The second thing is enshrined in the policy document is the fact that the ferries are actually an extension of the road system, the transportation network, and they're essential services, really, and that's where government should be spending money, is in essential services. John Cummins, our leader, had come out with a press announcement talking about some rebates for those who had to pay for ferries and tolls as part of their daily life. It got truncated a bit, and a lot of people, I think, misunderstood why we were adding an extra layer of government of tax and then giving back money. And the realization there is that, for occasional users who are using it for tourism or tourists coming here, there's a fair share of payment of our resources and our transportation infrastructure. But for people who use it for their core work, that's something that I think we should be looking at very carefully. Thank you.
Thank you. We just finished a very comprehensive consultation all across British Columbia about BC Ferries, so I'm going to cut to the chase because in spite of some of the illustrations, I think the real argument that's coming through is we should have BC Ferries as part of the highway system again, and that would solve everything. The reality is the challenges facing BC ferries are those facing ferry systems around the world. Declining ridership, rising fares, rising fuel costs. Whether or not BC Ferries was made part of the highway system, i.e. you weren't paying fares, you would still have to deal with the challenges of extremely low utilization in some places. The ferry commissioner outlined that ferry users, provincial taxpayer, and BC Ferries all have to be part of the solution. And it might be interesting for people to note that while fares are going up, they actually now form only 62% of the cost of BC Ferries, whereas a few years ago it was 64%, and it's been dropping. So currently, the taxpayer in British Columbia pays about $180 million a year to take up the rest of that cost.
So I'm going to open it up to another round of three questions. We've got a question over here, a question at the back, and then at the very back there. So there's a man with the glasses midway. Yes. One, two, and three. The woman standing. Yes. There's a woman.
Hi, so my name is Tiffany, and my question is about the $100 million that was spent on the turnstile system in TransLink and the new Compass program. I'd like to hear whether you think this was a good use of taxpayer money, and if not, what you would implement instead of this system.
Thanks, Tiffany. We'll start with Mary this time.
Sure. I think ultimately it will be. When you look at systems around the world, London's been mentioned, and I think any of us who've been to London, their turnstile system worked quite well, quite efficiently. People get through it fairly quickly. And I am one of those people who believes that the estimates on fare evasion and what could be recouped are probably low. I think we are probably seeing more of it than what's estimated, although we'll see that when the cards are introduced. The unfortunate part is that we didn't do that when we first built them. I think that's the unfortunate part, because retrofitting is so expensive. But I do think ultimately, in the long term, it will be a wise investment.
Tiffany, I'm not a transit engineer, and I don't have the information. I'm a data geek, and I've asked for data about that, and we haven't got the open data on that, so I don't know how many people are riding it. When you ask if I think it's a wise investment, I'm going to have to say no. I have two daughters who go to school in my riding, along with 300 other children, with asbestos dripping from the pipes. We have cracked asbestos insulation that's directly exposed to teachers, and the cost to fix that is less than $1 million. Okay, I just can't for the life of me see why the turnstiles would be more important. I'm sorry.
Thank you. To provide passengers safety and to avoid fare evasion, I think they'll do some of that work. But I think when they were a decision was made to institute them, the Minister of Transportation went to London. He said, well, they have those fare gates there. I'm going to have them here. The TransLink's internal study actually showed there was no business case. So, but the decisions are made, money spent, it's there. But I'm hoping that the passenger safety and the fare evasion that is being proposed right now, hopefully that we will recoup some of that money.
Right, Jamie.
Like Duane, I'm not a transportation engineer. I do understand that the perception of fare evasion and controlling that is part of the decision-making that drives us into these kinds of choices, and that they don't necessarily address the fundamental problems that we have within the transportation system, even the fare evasion system. So if the money has been spent, was it a good decision? I would have to say I doubt it.
Second one. Yep. Here we go.
Good evening. Lawrence Frank, a professor at UBC in sustainable transportation. This is an interesting dialogue. I'm curious about your thoughts of whether or not you would support a performance-based approach to transportation funding, where jurisdictions, by some formula, were given an incentive to change their land use patterns over time or to do a myriad of factors, adopt programs to support demand management was mentioned, an interest in data and objective measurement was mentioned, so that there was a rationalized approach to being able to say, you know, over the next 5 years, how well did this jurisdiction do in, you know, supporting the kind of investments that we might make? So why invest in transit in a jurisdiction that's not putting forward transit-supported land use. Would you support that or not? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Lawrence. I'm not a civil engineer as well as not being a transit engineer, so I can't talk about the specifics, but I'm a big fan of feedback loops and performance measurements. One of the projects I worked on with the U.S. Department of Energy was on smart buildings and measuring a building before and after an energy-efficient retrofit to be able to then make a blueprint for what other buildings would benefit from the same kind of refit to save energy. So what you're describing, although I don't know the specifics of how it would work, does make a lot of sense. And, you know, this is the kind of, you know, factual, scientific-driven approach that I really like. I'm a geek, so that's my nature. So,
Planning like that can absolutely change communities for the better. There's a really good example in what's taking place in the long-term community plan for the city of Langley, which will transform it into a place that would have mixed commercial residential instead of these low-rise, low-density commercial and then some more sprawl in terms of planning for residential parts of the community. Here's the challenge with that plan, and here's why I would hesitate, is that when it comes to community planning, we may all have an idea of how we could point to that community over there and tell them how they should plan their community. They have locally elected mayors and councillors who are elected to make those decisions. And I'll tell you that as a person who has grown up in the Valley and lives now in Langley, you do not catch as many flies with vinegar as you do with honey. And to try and tell communities south of the Fraser, for example, that thou shalt do what people in Vancouver want you to do doesn't go over really well.
I think there are a lot of merit to that that thought, and I think I give a lot more credit to the local mayors and local councillors to making those decisions, because they all understand land use decisions and transportation go hand in hand. They understand that. And I think, you know, if we work with them and encourage them to make those decisions accordingly, then they will, there will be benefit as far as the transportation services are concerned. I think they will agree, but you need to work with them. There's no doubt about that. You can't have top-down decision-making process as we see today. We know what's best for you, and we will make those decisions for you. But you need to work with those mayors. That's why it's important to bring those mayors back onto the TransLink board, work with them, and say, how do we plan for the entire Lower Mainland?
Thank you. Jane.
I think you've probably got lots more expertise than most of us in the room related to your thinking about how we could create more sustainable communities. And I do think that those kinds of strategies need to be part of the conversation. We've got lots of assumptions being tossed around here that we're going to continue to grow at the same rate that we're growing. We're going to be able to sprawl out till, who knows, maybe to Hope. In the Fraser Valley, and quite frankly, that's not going to happen. It can't happen if we want to deal with issues like climate change. So we do have to start thinking differently about how we're formulating our community, and we may need to use the stick approach in order to get our, or maybe an educational approach, so that we get our local communities understanding that the decisions that they make about land use have profound effects where further down the valley, upstream, downstream, and maybe we need to set conditions. We're going to do that, regulate business, we can regulate community.
Okay. Third question, Brenda? I think it was a gentleman on the right-hand side.
Yeah. Daryl from Surrey. The youth population, who are among the Metro's heavily transit-dependent and will be stymied by the lack thereof, are under 18 and will have no voice in the November 2014 referendum on TransLink funding. Was this considered? And with this now in mind, do you still think a referendum is the right way to address the issue of funding? Why or why not?
I'm going to start with you, Mary, since you mentioned the referendum.
So don't limit your thinking of a referendum to a yes, no, thumbs up, thumbs down as to whether or not TransLink should get more funding.
There are many different options for new funding sources for TransLink, and the idea is that the work we're currently doing between myself and the chair and the vice chair of TransLink would develop proposals which could be taken to the public, probably in combination. You're probably not going to find one, so it's probably going to be something like, here are three or four options, and which is your preferred one. In terms of youth, youth are always clamoring to have an influence, and they should, and it's exciting when they're involved in campaigns, and I have youth volunteers. But I think where you can have the impact is in the broad consultation that we will be engaged in between the spring of 2014 and when that referendum takes place. And I would encourage you to do that, because there's an awful lot that you can contribute in terms of daily experience and also your future.
Harry.
We are elected to make decisions no matter how tough they are. I think putting this issue to referendum, which will not take place another 18 months, I think it's a shirking off our responsibility. I think that shouldn't happen. September 2010, the province signed a memorandum of understanding with the local mayors, committing themselves that they will find a long-term sustainable funding formula to pay for the services that we need today and for the long term. Today, we are talking about the same thing over again, that we will find a long-term sustainable funding formula through now referendum. It's the south of the Fraser communities who are waiting and waiting to see if there's going to be expansion of public transportation in that area, because that's the fastest growing community. All those 1.2 million people that I talked about, many of them will be moving into south of the Fraser, and I think we are shirking off our responsibility as politicians. I think it's not going well, and it's not the right thing to do.
Jane.
Referendums are a very imperfect way to gauge the people's support for projects. And they tend to be divisive in communities rather than bringing community together. They tend to be deemed to be community consultation when in fact they're not. They're just simply a majority rules kind of forcing of opinion on a region. And often just a slight majority will set the stage. So I personally don't think a referendum is a way to approach these large-scale questions. I think we need to have better land use planning, and I think we need to have better community, the involvement of people in community, to look at how we're going to set the conditions for how we move forward in this region.
Duane.
Well, it's a boring debate when most of the candidates agree on one thing, and I think that the referendum is perhaps a very wasteful potential to go forward. Elected officials are supposed to make certain decisions, and there's other ways to collect public input into the decision-making process, consultations. I was at an open house with Councillor Jeff Meggs and Gregor Robertson, and we had a full house. We had a lot of really good ideas going and discussing the UBC SkyTrain extension. There are very effective ways to deal with these kinds of deals. I believe referendums should really be reserved for instances where there's a conflict of interest perhaps within government, and maybe the government shouldn't be making the decision without the public consultation. When it comes to, Daryl, to your question about the youth and not be feeling disenfranchised with it, in my riding, if elected, I'll be holding regular town hall meetings, because MLAs should listen to the constituents, to all the constituents. You know, good idea. When I worked at Adobe, we had a motto, which is good ideas can come from everywhere. Thanks.
It's quite incredible. If you think of this issue, we've already covered governance, funding, planning, turnstiles, and referendum in very few short questions. I'm going to go to the Twitter world now and back to Chris.
A short and sweet question from Twitter. Why do we talk about goods movement and people movement separately?
Harry, we're going to start with you. And
sir, could you repeat the question?
Why do we talk about goods movement and people movement separately?
It's a good question, and I think, for people movement, we need public transportation, and for goods movement, we need trucks, and we need rails, we need short sea shipping, and all those different modes of transportation. Those two are two different modes of transportation, and that's why we need to look at both. If we can move some of the cars, that is supposed to move people, and then that will make it much more efficient for the truckers, for other modes of transportation to move goods that will be needed to service the population that we need to move out of the public transport or through public transportation.
Duane.
Well, this is where what I was going to say to Mary afterwards would give you an idea of me as an amateur engineer. I agree, Chris, whoever sent that question has a good point. You know, doing the subway route, duplicating SkyTrain, has a lot of limitations with respect to that. If we were to use the existing rail corridors were available from VCC through down to the Athletes Village up to Falls Creek to Granville Island, the trains don't have to just carry people. They actually can carry cargo as well. We can get trucks off the road. We can clear up our streets for cyclists, for other purposes. There's a lot of wisdom to a lot of people who are providing input into the transportation, and I know it probably drives Mary nuts on a daily basis, but I think there's a lot of validity to the idea of mixed-use rail within the city.
Let's go over to you, Jane.
I think it's a good question. Why do we talk about the movement of people and goods separately? The more we do that, the more we have these perceptions that we have to have a different philosophy of developing our communities because we have trade on one hand and people on the other. The Green Party believes that we really need to move to a different economic model, one that's based in strong local communities. And if we have strong local communities, then we need less travel for our goods and ourselves. We can design our communities around that that philosophy of how do we go about creating that intact community that has our goods locally, so we travel less, the goods travel less to us. It would mean we could have smaller homes. It could mean that we have more leisure time. And so I think it's an excellent question and one that we as transportation planners need to be thinking about. Maybe we need to bring those two thoughts together in our planning.
Thank you. I apologize. I'm getting over a cold, so I've got the bit of the remnants of it. I can tell you why I do. I do because very often in our more urban environments, people forget about the importance of freight and goods movement in British Columbia. We're a small open trading economy. We now are the province least dependent on the United States for trade. It's hugely important to future growth, which is hugely important to funding all the programs that we believe are important, including things like transit and BC ferries. So the reason that I do is because very often in our Metro Vancouver world, people forget about the importance of goods movement, and you need to constantly keep that on the table so that you are remembering the balance that you have to strike.
Next three questions. We're going to go one here, one right down here, and we'll take one right at the back. The last question at the back. So one Peter Ladner here, there was one, I think it was on this side.
Hi, Peter Ladner here, I won't stand up. one of the things that's killing the provincial economy is rising healthcare costs. And we are now knowing, thanks to the work of people like Larry Frank, the impacts of the way we move on our health. We know, for example, car dependency is contributing to the obesity epidemic, which is contributing to a lot of these costs that could easily be, these diseases that could easily be avoided with different planning and different ways of moving around. Are you prepared to make health care implications a priority in deciding transportation spending?
I'm going to go to Jane this time to start.
Great question. I think absolutely. We think that the social determinants of health, the community determinants of health, ought to be part of our land use planning. So absolutely.
Harry.
Certainly it is one of the determinants what kind of a transportation system that we should have. It deals with the economy, it deals with our health, it deals with our quality of life, environment. All those fits together. I think those are the determining factor why we need to have a good transportation system so that we could deal with all those issues.
Thank you. And when I was when I had responsibility for public health, I came smack into all those statistics, and they're very stark.
We do have to acknowledge, I think, off the top, that not every community in British Columbia is going to be a place where walking and cycling can form a significant part of transportation at many times during the year. But for those of us in the Lower Mainland, and particularly in urban environments, creating communities where walkability is possible, creating communities where you have higher densities that allow for better expansion of transit faster, those are all things that contribute to good health. What we've done in policy is ensured that, first of all, when we construct major infrastructure projects, they will always have cycling infrastructure built into them. Portman, probably the best example, largest cycling infrastructure project in the history of the province. And when it's done, it'll connect on both sides to the cycling pathways that we've created, both on the Coquitlam side and also on the Surrey side. But it's the same is true for Sea to Sky, W.R. Bennett, or indeed as we get to the George Massey Tunnel. That's one example. My time's up. Sorry.
So, Peter, you're asking me, and I'm a guy who spent most of my life racing for money, racing bicycles. I love cycling. But it's not always as simple as that either. Last July, I was riding on one of the cycling paths on West 7th Avenue, and I got hit head-on by a car. It's the reason I'm not cycling down here tonight, where I had to drive my car. I'm still injured from that. There is definitely a huge incentive. I believe in physical fitness. I believe in staying in shape. I don't know how much you can correlate it with the transit plan to a very certain degree. If the data supports that a lot of people will ride their bike if there's a new bike corridor, I'm the first guy in line to say, let's do it, okay? I love cycling, it's my life. But unless the data is there that we can make factual decisions, there's, you know, no point in starting to, you know, retrofit streets that nobody's going to use. So I'm a little bit mixed on it.
Agar, and I have the privilege of volunteering with Carbon Talks. When I'm talking about transportation issues, I always have to wonder how much of these are divided along socioeconomic lines, and I thought maybe you could comment on that.
So how much are transportation issues divided on socioeconomic lines? Duane, we're going to start with you this time.
Sure. Sorry, I didn't catch your name, but
Betsy.
It's Betsy. It's actually, we've seen some data that suggests that it is. And with the carbon tax in particular, you have this distinction that some of the people who cannot really have access to affordable or alternative ways of transportation are being unfairly hit. And same with the bridge tolls. We've taken action already. We've expressed that if we get into the legislature, we're going to be very active in trying to help some of the people who are being unfairly hit by those taxes. I was lucky in life. I was a high-tech success. I made a lot of money. I can very easily pay a toll or, you know, make alternative arrangements or not go to work. Not everybody can. It's not the reality. And I think that as a society, when we're looking at next generation transportation, we have to take into account that there are people out there that are dependent on us making the decisions to actually protect them, the people who are least available to take care of themselves.
Jane, over to you.
I think that we need to acknowledge that low-income people are disproportionately punished on virtually every aspect of living, from transportation to healthcare to access to jobs to virtually everything that we do. We do know that often cheaper housing is found further and further out, and that people have to spend a lot of time commuting. That's very costly to low-income people. They often have to drive cheap vehicles that are much more expensive to maintain and to drive, and so that's more expensive to low-income people. And so when we're planning transportation, I think that we need to find a way to get the voices of to ensure that we don't disproportionately continue to penalize the people who are low and moderate income.
Thank you. So in thinking about your question, I think, first of all, probably what is a greater divisiveness in transportation policy is regional, because of the differences in regional needs, regional requirements, regional desires for what they want to achieve. But in terms of what the impact of transportation policy and socioeconomics,
I actually think that the from what I hear from people and from what I see from the taxation data versus what comes back in tax credits and programs, et cetera, the folks who are the most challenged right now in terms of affordability, and I think it includes the area of transit, are those in that middle class. Governments over many years, not just ours, previous governments, have done a lot to take a look at very low-income people. And it's left quite a significant gap in terms of programming and tax credit consideration for those who are in that middle income bracket. And if you look at the taxation and credit data, and if you look at what's there for programs, it's the middle class who are the most challenged.
Thank you. And I think, you know, the decisions that are being made about public transportation, the low-income people and the middle class, they are being hit, and because of the taxes like carbon tax and gas tax, they're made to continue to pay, but we haven't given them the public transportation system to leave their cars and go to the public transportation. I think public transportation system can actually equalize some of the uses. Regardless of where you fit in the economic ladder, because if it's affordable, if it's accessible, if it's efficient.
Hi, my name is Tony Valente. In a recent article, Peter Ladner wrote, and he suggested that we need one list of projects in Metro Vancouver. And Peter, I'm very happy you're here to hear this tonight. And so what he was suggesting was we don't need one list of projects with TransLink and one with the Ministry of Transportation. And yes, I'm referring to the Massey Tunnel project. And so I would ask candidates, do you agree we need one list? Why or why not? And if so, how do you propose we get there?
Okay. Harry, we're going to start with you. What now? So that was Tony, and he was asking the question on, do you agree that there should be one list? Or perhaps, Tony, you could clarify. There's currently two, one for Ministry of Transportation, one for TransLink, or should we go to you, Peter, and ask for the clarification? Yeah. Tony?
Maybe better ask Peter, actually.
No, you go ahead. So you were referring to
two. My understanding is that there's one list for Ministry of Transportation and one list for TransLink, and they're not
treated combined.
On one list for this region.
Yeah, so the... If I understand your question correctly, the TransLink is to deliver us the public transportation in Lower Mainland and the roads and the bridges that comes within their jurisdiction. But then there are projects, bridges, and roads that are outside of the TransLink jurisdiction that comes under the Ministry of Transportation, such as Massey Tunnel. And Patolo becomes, it is the part of the TransLink. So you're suggesting whether it should come under Ministry of Transportation rather than leaving it under transportation, some of the Lower Mainland areas?
I'm suggesting that if we're going to allocate capital to something, we do it in a consistent manner, whether it's money coming from the Ministry of Transportation or TransLink.
So everyone heard that? We need to do it in a consistent manner. I'm just going to give Harry a few more minutes.
The way it is set up now, the TransLink is given a number of revenue sources, and they use that for their operating funding. And also they use part of that to pay for the debt servicing, the debt that they incur when they spend on capital. The Ministry of Transportation deal with the highways and the bridges that comes under Ministry of Transportation outside of the TransLink. Now, that's the decision that we could make, but I think that's the decision that was made. And I think right now it's not a bad decision. Leave TransLink where they are, give them tools that they need to provide us the services that they need that we need, and help them with the capital funding wherever we can by engaging both levels of government.
And in fairness, you have a few extra seconds here, Mary, as well.
So I'm going to take a stab at imagining that what Peter's getting at is that you're not going to be successful if your planning isn't integrated. Provincial highways, though, do serve a broader purpose than what you would see TransLink being responsible for in terms of its governance. I'm not saying there isn't some crossover. There is. But there are distinctly two jurisdictions, and if you look at a route like 99, there are very many other purposes that go beyond what TransLink would ever be responsible for. Having said that, we are doing a lot better now with planning together around the major road network that TransLink is responsible for. Good example is the Patulla Bridge. We have right now the project group is made up of TransLink representatives, representatives from the City of Surrey, representatives from the City of New Westminster, and also senior ministry staff, and they are working together to plan what's going to happen on the patella. We will engage in the same kind of dialogue around the Massey Tunnel, making sure that we're integrating with the existing road network, and that we're also thinking about how we will eventually utilize that corridor to improve bus transportation. We have, for example, within the current project that is taking place with South Fraser Perimeter Road and some of the improvements leading up to Massey, dedicated bus lanes that are being put in. So we are already doing that 100-year thinking and thinking forward to how we integrate transit into that corridor.
I'm not going to second guess whether Peter's suggestion is good or is not good. But my party does believe that there needs to be a lot more taxpayer scrutiny on TransLink in particular, and specifically a lot more ability to provide input from the public in the process. If there is an efficiency to doing it one way or the other, I would listen to both sides of the argument and make up my mind from those who are actually working in the field to tell me which way is best. The integration, though, the way that Mary had summed it up, if it could be more efficient, if we plan an integrated system for the whole valley and we take into account kind of a more holistic view of public transit or the next generation of transit, I'm all for it. As far as the list goes, I'm not sure. I wasn't really clear what the alternative is to one list. If the one list represents planning an integrated approach and the alternative is to not plan it as an integrated approach, I think I'd rather take it as an integrated approach. So,
Jane.
I think that one list is important, but I think before we make lists, we need to look at what is the purpose of our transportation system, and are there alternative ways of approaching what we're trying to do? For instance, there were some UBC professors that indicated that for the money we spent on the Portman Bridge, we could have had rail throughout the lower mainland to Surrey. And if we are able to think differently about what our current needs are and what our future needs are, maybe we would make different decisions about how we would approach the transportation system. What I hear over and over again is roads and bridges, and that is old thinking, and we need new thinking for a different form of community of the future.
This will be the last question coming from Twitter, and I wanted to just give the heads up as well. We're going to be going to closing statements, and you've been very tame tonight. This has been we've been also very polite and Canadian tonight, haven't we? But just to give you a little warning, last question, and then we'll go to closing statements.
Sure. We've had a number of questions on Twitter about pedestrians, so one of them being, what would your party do to promote safer streets for pedestrians and cyclists?
So we've got streets, and I'm going to go to Jane this time to start. Safer streets for pedestrians and cyclists.
That's very much a local government issue, a community issue of how we're going to create safer streets. And again, there's a price tag for everything that we have to do in order to do that. It's an enormous amount of money to build sidewalks. Sidewalks need to be thought of differently if we're really going to be pedestrian-friendly communities. They have to be wider, they have to be more pleasing in terms of making sure that there are places to go, village kinds of concepts. And we are committed as a party to more infrastructure for pedestrians, more infrastructure for cyclists, safer infrastructure in both of those modes of transportation. Again, we're looking at how do we transition our economy off this belief that we can dig up BC and sell it to China, and how do we create strong local economies throughout British Columbia that serve the people and the communities that we want to have in the future.
Right. Mary.
Thank you. Jane's quite right. The walking part of it, the pedestrian part of it, really is mainly a local issue. Our responsibility is for highways, and of course people don't typically, there aren't typically many pedestrians on highways. I will say this, though. In terms of cycling, I've mentioned that our policy is to include cycling infrastructure within major road projects. We also, though, in terms of pedestrians and cyclists, have a partnership with local governments where we fund through Bike BC, for example, since 2001, about $148 million in local projects in communities all around the province. And the same is true through projects like a Local Motion and others, where we share funding with local governments for priorities that they have around better pedestrian infrastructure. So there are ways to contribute to it, and it's but it has to be done with the local governments. Oh, I should add one thing since I have a minute. One thing that was raised to me and that I think we really need...
Oh. We'll come back to it. You'll have a minute. Harry.
Thank you. And I think many communities outside of TransLink already are working on having a biking program and walking programs as far as having a better and safe sidewalks and biking trails. But if TransLink and the local communities here in Lower Mainland can work better and have a better coordination, I think we can improve upon that. And outside of Lower Mainland, other communities are looking at, and many of them have actually adopted biking lanes, and it's costly. And they always are looking at and looking up to the provincial government for additional help. And you know, many of the biking activists are out there lobbying, and I think they're doing a good job, and we need to improve both of those areas.
So I'm going to just answer with the fact that, I mean, if the question, Chris, was directed at what's going to make it safer for pedestrians and cyclists, and you're addressing provincial MLA candidates, I'm presuming that that is directed at the roads that are under the care of the provincial government. I, for one, have actually been happy with what's happened with Highway 99, with the provisions for bicycling. I think it was really good. I'd like to see that continue. There's not a lot of time, though, when I would recommend to somebody that they should be walking on a provincial highway. It's not always the best, safest thing to do. If there's no alternative, certainly, and it's a necessity, I think that's something that has to be factored into the regional transit plan. I mean, walking is part of transit. Whether you have trains, whether you have cars, bicycles, buses, whatever, you still have to walk to and from them. So
one of the problems in any kind of forum like this is we're only getting at a fraction of the questions. So I want to just get a show of hands. If you could have asked a question, just put up your hand if you had a question to ask.
Oh, my.
Take a look at that. I had many. What I'm going to ask you to do is if you are on Twitter or you are on Facebook, let's get this dialogue really going. Go to our hashtag, BCTranspo, or go to the Carbon Talks or the SFU Public Square or any of these candidates or any of the political parties or the independents that you met or the other political parties that you've heard from tonight and ask those questions. Let's start and ensure that the whole issue of transportation is on the agenda for this election. I am sorry that we weren't able to get to a number of the questions that you had, because I know there were many good ones. But we did get to 12, and that's not a bad start. And I have to commend our incredible candidates here for the, I think, the intellectual rigor that they have brought to this conversation. I think it's been great. Now, what I want to do is I'm going to go to all of you. This time I'm going to go in alphabetical order by your last name. So, Harry, you're getting the warning first. For your closing statements and 2 minutes to share your wisdom and brilliant thoughts, the things that you want us to leave with tonight as we go forth and vote. So, Harry, no pressure.
Thank you. As I said before, regardless what we think about the Metro Vancouver, statistics show, and their assumptions are, that 1.2 million additional people will be living in Lower Mainland in the next 30 years. We need to start planning today so that we can start, you know, have a plan to move them and the goods to service them. We cannot do that if we continue to go the route that we are going today. We need to, first of all, catch up to the transit services that we need today, especially south of the Fraser. There is a 1 hour or service on per capita basis compared to on the other side of the river. It doesn't mean that the Vancouver and Burnaby and Richmond have number one and the best public transportation system. It just shows how far behind South of the Fraser is. To say that we will put that question to referendum to deal with that issue, I think it's a shirking of responsibility. We cannot afford to do that. So what we need to do, make the TransLink governance start working again by changing, by bringing the locally elected people onto that board so that when they're making land use decision and public transportation decisions, that they know exactly what they're talking about. Then use some of the carbon tax money. Money's already there. Take some of that money, take it to the newly appointed board or elected board and say, look, here's some of the money that we need to deal with some of the traffic concessions and some of the pass-ups that we have, the people having to wait at the bus stations, bus stops all this time, that we need to fix that problem immediately and what can we do to deal with the long-term solution by coming up with a long-term sustainable funding formula, working with those local mayors so that we have a world-class public transportation system that is efficient, that is affordable, and that is actually user-friendly.
Thank you. Duane.
In the software industry, we use something called patterns, and it's modeled from a book by a brilliant Viennese-born architect called Christopher Alexander. And the idea is to look around for patterns that work and apply them where we can. And I think that is one of the fundamental cores of what the regional transit planning needs to take into account. Now, I'm with the BC Conservative Party. We're not the Federal Conservative Party. I'm a fiscal conservative. Thank you. I'm a fiscal conservative. We believe that every dollar paid by taxpayers is held in trust, and it should be held in trust in a transparent manner that's spent in an accountable way in your best interests. And that's I know it's a new idea in government, so... We believe that there's a lot of good ideas. I've heard actually really good ideas from all of the candidates tonight. You know, everybody has a part, a voice to play in this. There's some good ideas. The one question about the moving of goods, going with an S-Bahn, we can certainly use the same train system to deliver goods within the city instead of using all these different trucks to deliver goods around the core lines. We also believe in our party that government should be scaled back to providing essential services. Transportation is an essential service, and efficient transportation is a right that we should have in this province, not just for Vancouver, not just for the Lower Mainland. We're thinking largely tonight, I think, in terms of the Lower Mainland, but there's still the island, the north, the interior. There's a number of other regions that can benefit from improvements in transportation. So we need to have a balanced perspective on it. One last thing, to keep the conversation going on Twitter, yes, I did tweet up here on the stage. I am at Duane Nickull, and I'm happy to, if you follow me, I'm happy to go ahead and answer questions after the forum. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane, and thank you for that offer as well. Mary. Yeah.
Thank you, and thank you very much for the dialogue tonight. I've quite enjoyed it. It's wonderful to have an opportunity to really be throwing back and forth the ideas and unpack them a little bit. Clearly from our dialogue tonight, and I can tell you from being Transportation and Infrastructure Minister, there are no simple answers to any of the questions that we've been asking. But we all know they need to be asked, and I want to leave you with some things to think about as you construct your Twitter questions. Certainly use the hashtag that Shauna gave you. Use our Twitter handles. Mine is at Mary4BC. We love to get your questions, especially during an election. But I think what we're recognizing is that regardless of who's elected to Victoria or even our local governments, there's some really big questions we have to wrestle with as a society. All of us are going to have to think about, in particular on the Lower Mainland. How do we envision transportation that works for the entire province? We're a big place. You could probably pave all of Saskatchewan for the same cost as a few miles of Mountain British Columbia Highway. How do we wrestle with that in a world that is moving to different types of standards and expectations? A growing population south of the Fraser, which, much as folks in Vancouver think about their needs, folks south of the Fraser think, you know what, I don't want to pay for Vancouver's transit. And finally, when we think about goods movement, we want to have our quiet and pastoral settings. We want to have our green environment. We also want to be able to afford the services that we need to keep our society whole.
How are we going to deal with increased goods movement, trade with Asia potentially, more trade with Asia, perhaps more trade with other countries? How much of that do we want to do? Where do we want it to take place? These are questions that no government in one legislative session or in one debate like this are going to be able to answer. But all of us together can, but we have to be free to dialogue about it and to throw these ideas out. And thank you for doing that tonight.
Thank you, Mary. Jane.
Well, I want to thank you all for your questions and for coming and having more questions. I have a sense that we haven't really addressed the real issues, that there are all kinds of things that are based in assumption, based in misunderstanding. And I even have a sense that there may be more expertise out there than there is here if we really wanted to get to better planning for our future. I know there are university professors. I know there are people with lifetimes worth of experience that we should tap into. And I think we're dealing with a phenomenon which the Green Party is very concerned about, and that is that we have this push at the point of an election where we want to have some input, some influence with our government. And then after the election's over, we find no means to have that influence. And the Green Party doesn't believe that that's a sustainable model for government for the future. We think that we need to be engaging citizens around all of these issues. They are life and death issues in terms of the survival of the planet. There are lots of ideas that the Green Party has. Our Green Book 2013 is online on our website, greenparty.bc.ca, under new ideas. We have got lots of ideas for transportation related to climate change. We've got lots of ideas for transportation related to the economy. We've got lots of ideas for transportation related to the sustainableness of our social services. So we've got great ideas, and you've got great ideas. And we can't just allow our elections to be that barrier. I've heard politicians say tonight that we're elected to make the decisions, but that isn't the way that our democracy will improve. Our democracy will improve if the elected politicians are reaching out to the people that they represent and bringing the ideas of all of those people together into the legislature. Thank you.
Thank you. One of the things I don't think we do enough is acknowledge the people that run for office. And it takes a great deal of personal sacrifice, a great deal of persistence, and tenacity to do what you do. And I just want to take a moment to just acknowledge all of you on this panel and all of you who are running for office, have run for office, or are currently in office. I mean, I see one of our councillors here in the city of Vancouver, Jeff Meggs, in the audience as well. So I just want to take a moment to acknowledge and thank you for doing that. The other thing I wanted to talk about for a moment is this is a process of consultation. It's the beginning of this election period, and we want this issue to stay alive, and I think that's up to many of you, your colleagues, your friends, to keep the issue alive and to keep it alive in each of the ridings. So I'm going to ask you to take a moment to think about how you can keep the transportation issue alive in your own riding, and also to keep the conversation. As Jane pointed out, there's a great deal of expertise in this room. So as the questions come in on Twitter, please also take the opportunity to respond to those questions. We're going to hope that the candidates as well. We'd like to get your Twitter hashtags, perhaps, and so that we can direct questions your way. But we also want to tap into the knowledge that's within this room and outside of this room. One of the things that's going to be happening in the next few months is something called Moving in a Livable Region, Investing in Transportation for a Growing Economy. This is a year-long consultation process that is being undertaken by Simon Fraser University, with the Mayor's Council, with Metro Vancouver, with TransLink, with Get On Board, with the Sustainable Coalitions, the Better Environmentally Sound Transportations, Urban Development Institute, many others. It's probably one of the most comprehensive consultations on the issues of governance, planning, and funding for transportation. So I want to extend that invitation to you, each of you, to tap into that. And by doing so, if you contact us or leave us with your contact information, you've got evaluations on each of your chairs, and you can add your email to that, and we'll make sure that you're included in that consultation process. We are a university, and one of the things that is central to our university is the students that go here. So we've asked Nick Smith, who is our SFU coordinator for Get On Board and with SFU Sustainability, to help us close tonight's meeting. Nick, come on up.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Nick Smith, and I'm here tonight on behalf of Sustainable SFU, one of the partners organizing this event. But I'm also a student at SFU in public health, and so I gotta say I'm very happy about the question that Peter Ladner asked tonight about transportation and health. So thank you for that. But as a public health student, I have my own vision for transportation, the transportation system in our region, a vision that is, you know, of a healthy, sustainable, and an affordable transportation system. And I think we've heard tonight from the questions that we've had in the audience that many people in the audience have their own visions for what they believe the future of our transportation system should look like. And so I guess it's at this time now, as we're nearing an election, that we turn to our elected leaders to help us realize and implement these visions. So we thank all the candidates for being with us here tonight, both here on stage and those in the audience. Now, I have the honor of having a number of thank yous to make, and quite a few. And the first that I'd like to say is thank you to all of you for being here. We know it's a wet night tonight, and we really do appreciate the effort that you all made to be here. We had many fantastic and insightful questions from the audience, and we thank you for those as well. Again, I'd like to thank the candidates for taking time to be here and sharing their ideas as well as their party's visions for the transportation future of our region. And to show our thanks for each of them for being here, we do have a number of gifts. So Shauna, if you could please, thank you. So firstly, would you like to start at this end?
Starting with Jane.
Okay. So thank you very much, Green Party Jane Sterk, for being here. And Harry Bains of the NDP, thank you. Mary Polak of the Liberal Party. And finally, Duane Nickull of the BC Conservative Party, thank you. And a couple other thank yous just for our fantastic partners that we had for tonight's event. The Center for Dialogue, SFU Public Square, Carbon Talks, the SFU City Program, and Sustainable SFU. We'd like to thank all these organizations for their generosity and their help in making tonight a success. So just a couple announcements. As we close the session, I'd like to invite everyone here to fill out an evaluation form, which were on your chairs as you came in, which you can hand to any of our volunteers as you leave tonight. But please don't leave just yet. We're going to have another half hour or so where we can mix and mingle. You can pick the brains of our candidates here. So please do stick around and mingle with us. You may have noticed on your way in that we had representatives from Get Your Vote On here. And if you have not yet registered to vote, we do very much encourage you to do that. So once again, just thank you all for coming. And have a safe trip home, however it is that you may be getting there.